Just that way of reasoning pushed us to a direction which suggested that, yes, there must be a light tower in our universe, and that light tower we identify with dark matter. So in other words, the dark matter, which is this bread and butter of this mysterious mass in the universe, and the dark energy, which is pervading everywhere and we have no idea, we think are related.
Mm-hmm.
It is the extremeness applied to dark energy, or this distance or duality conjecture, which suggests there must be a tower. Now, you could say, what is this tower? Where is this tower? How do you actually, what is the mass scale? How do you see it? So combining this general idea I told you with other observations, it turns out there's only one possibility. The possibility is that there's one of the dimensions of the microscopic dimensions are actually bigger than the rest, and of the scale dictated by dark energy, and that energy scale amounts to about a micron, 1,000th of a millimeter. So we are saying that there must be one of these dimensions bigger than the rest, of the order of 1,000th of a millimeter, a micron. But our universe, the 3+1 dimensional space-time, which we are living in terms of electrons, quarks, and all that, are in a hyperplane in this higher dimension. So you imagine you have one higher dimension, but we are on a hypersurface on that, stuck on that, and the size of that is about a micron. So we got this from just applying the Swampland principle, the distance conjecture, which I try to explain why it's so natural from the physics perspective, because the duality of string theory demands it. So if you just tip it and say, okay, let me assume without knowing exactly how I get my universe from string theory, just that idea, what does it imply? You immediately get these kind of predictions, and the micron scale size of this extra dimension is actually observable potentially in our universe, because they have gone up to 30 microns and they haven't seen it. So how do they see it? Well, they put two particles and they measure the force between them. If the force goes like 1/r², then you're in 3 dimensions.
Yes.
If it goes like 1/r³, then you're in 4-dimensional space. So you have grown a space dimension. So they want to see if the force becomes stronger.
The force of?
Gravity. Of gravity. So I'm saying that Newton's gravitational force law, being 1/r², becomes stronger at higher dimensions. But if the extra dimension has a micron scale, and if you are separated more than a micron scale, you won't feel the extra dimension. It looks like 3-dimensional. But if you bring it closer so that you can feel the extra dimension, if you're within less than a micron.
Yeah, that's super interesting. One of the questions that I had was going to be, look, is there something about the extra dimensions of string theory that necessitate compactifying to something extremely small? And you're saying, no, this is relatively large. Now it's a micron, but that's relatively large.
This is extremely large in some sense, surprisingly. And I'm saying this is not that the string theory forces you. This is observation combined with the Swampland idea. So in other words, we are, as I explained, sometimes you have an idea that, okay, you should not be to the left or to the right of this line, etc. That's like the distance conjecture, that if you go for large distance in the field space, you hit a tower of light particles. But then you say, oh, but I know in our universe, lambda is blah and blah. What does that imply? Then you can use this. So it doesn't tell you lambda or the cosmological constant had to be small. But if it is small, then you can use it.
And would this say that dark matter is several particles? It's not just a single one? It's a tower of them?
Well, so the tower that I'm talking about turns out to be one particle, namely just graviton. Now, you might say, wait a second, graviton is massless. But 3+1 dimensional graviton is massless, but 4+1 dimensional graviton is not massless, because the graviton can have waves, oscillations in the other direction. This tower I'm talking about is nothing but oscillations of graviton. So it unifies gravity with dark matter. So dark matter is nothing but excitations of the graviton, which is why it's weak. Weakly interacting, because gravity is weakly interacting. So the dark matter becomes the tower of these graviton, which is weakly interacting anyhow. So it unifies dark matter with graviton and dark energy into one package.
Does this then have a name, like a separate
dark dimension? We call this dark dimension scenario. Yes. So dark dimension scenario is a scenario that there's one extra dimension opening up. And this is coming from this Swampland idea I just told you. So there are a few other predictions that this makes about cosmology, in particular about axion physics and other things that are potentially also very interesting. And ultimately, it's an answer to a kind of an answer to a question that Dirac was asking. Dirac had noticed that different scales in physics has bizarre relations by factors of 10 to the 30, 10 to the 20, 10 to the 40, what these big numbers. And he was saying, it looks like they are not related by factors of 2 or 3. They are related like by powers. What is the reason for this? So in the context of Swampland, we have actually seen exactly the reasoning for why they are powers. And more than that, we find things are given by powers of 1/12 of the cosmological constant. So things come in chunks of lambda to the 1/12.
Huh.
And that's about 10 to the minus 10. So you get 10 to the minus 10, 10 to the minus 20, 10 to the minus 30, etc. And these give you the different scales in physics. One of them gives you the higher dimensional Planck scale. The other one gives you the weak scale. Another one gives you the neutrino scale. Another one gives you the large scale of physics, the large size of the universe. So all of these scales fit into this hierarchical fashion given by the dark energy. So the dark energy gives you the a unifying principle about all these different scales.
This dark dimension theory, when did it occur to you and your collaborators? Like, how long was the time span?
It gradually developed. So the distance conjecture was started around 2006.
Okay.
The fact that you go, but then we applied the distance conjecture to the case of cosmological constants in another paper. I think that was 2018. And then in a few years past, we tried to think about cosmological aspects of it. And then we gradually were going in the direction, and in the 2022, it led to the actual say, why not? Combining this gives you that. So the idea came gradually, but it could have been done much faster.
What do you think about de Sitter quantum gravity?
Well, quantum gravity, de Sitter seems to have a problem of stability. And so a lot of these ideas in the context of Swampland seem to point towards the idea that de Sitter space with positive energy cannot be stable. Well, the question would be, okay, if they are not stable, what is the scale of, what's the time scale of the instability? And what we think is that the time scale of the instability is itself set by de Sitter. That means it's what we call the Hubble scale. So, for example, if you take that in our universe, it suggests that the scale in which the universe will unwind or the dark energy will unwind is roughly the age of the universe, current universe. So that is kind of interesting because it will tell you that the dark energy has a time scale associated with it also. And we don't know if the recent observation of DESI, which the dark energy survey, which tried to see whether dark energy is constant or not, they seem to have some indication that dark energy is actually changing and decreasing with time in the same kind of time scale as one would naively think about along the lines I'm talking about. So these kind of ideas tell you that dark energy is actually dynamical and actually evolving potentially in time. It's certainly not stable. So quantum gravity of de Sitter should not exist in the sense of a complete de Sitter. It could be just patches, short time maybe, but not in the long term. In the long term, it will decay.
So does that mean that our universe, which is de Sitter, will decay?
Yes. Correct. We expect our universe not to be stable. In fact, I think every string theorist believes that we just don't know exactly the time scale. The arguments emanating from Swampland suggest that the time scale is given by the Hubble, which is roughly the age of the current universe. So that's the kind of a time scale.
You're saying that the age of the universe is the expected age of a de Sitter universe,
yes,
to collapse.
Up to a log factor, which I didn't tell you about. So in other words, it's age up to a logarithmic correction. So if you want to get the upper bound, we think it's like 2 or 3 trillion years.
Okay.
So it's about, since it's upper bound, we don't think it's going to be more than 2 or 3 trillion years. This is an idea from Swampland, which has less of an evidence because we don't have examples of de Sitter from string theory. So we have extrapolated what we know to get this. It's what's called the Trans-Planckian censorship conjecture. So this is one of the things that we are trying to gather more evidence for.
Mm-hmm.
Check it to see if it's correct, if it's not correct, and so on. But the idea suggests that there's this upper bound. But at any rate, all the examples we know in the context of string theory, which has dark energy, is always unstable. The question is whether how unstable they are, and that's what we are trying to figure out.
Why did you call that a problem? Because when I asked, just to reiterate, okay, what do you think about de Sitter quantum gravity? You said the problem is that it's unstable. Why is that a problem?
Yeah, because de Sitter, when people talk about de Sitter, they mean everlasting de Sitter. If you're just having a piece of de Sitter, then that's different. So in other words, there's a time. De Sitter has a time axis.
Ah, okay.
So if you take the curvature or the scale of de Sitter and extrapolate in time, we're saying it won't last. So therefore, it's not de Sitter. You call it de Sitter or not, it becomes ambiguous.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.